Doctors make a lot of money. A lot. Doctors are rich. Or so goes the stereotype in our society. But as with everyone trapped in similar stereotypes, it's not the money you make, but the money you save that matters. So today, we talk to a doctor who will share his financial journey and how he has avoided money mistakes. I'm Edric Mendoza, and this is On The Money. We are joined today by Tony Huerto, an anesthesiologist working in one of the country's biggest hospitals. Hi, Doc Tony.
Hi, Edric.
Welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me here.
Yeah, we're very eager to see your story and the things you've learned about money. I want to start off by asking, so is it true about the stereotype that all doctors really make a lot of money?
Well, that's a misconception.
It is, okay.
Yeah. How so? A lot of doctors are, well, make modest income, but not really to the point that you can call them rich or extravagantly rich.
Okay. Yeah. When you say modest, what, like person who is just fresh out of college, who's not exactly a professional, or?
Modest, middle managerial
level. Okay. Yeah. As opposed to exorbitantly or extravagantly wealthy, which could be the stereotype.
Not,
wow, you know, he's a
not
doctor.
Not the case for most cases.
All right. So what would you think in general, you know, doctors, what are the, so since, you know, they come in different earning brackets as well, I assume doctors make money mistakes as well.
Of course, definitely.
So what would you say are the most common ones that doctors make in general?
Well, most common ones would be investing in the wrong financial instruments, buying insurances which are not appropriate for their needs, and spending on luxurious items more than they would for the essentials.
Would you say that doctors also find themselves in debt because of that? I mean,
that's true, yeah. I would say that is true for some cases.
All right. Yeah. Why don't you give us an idea of, you know, how it all started for you, how you got involved in dealing with money?
Yeah. I started investing my money when I was way back in first year college.
Wow.
That's about 20 years ago.
Good for you.
Yeah. I traded the stock market with a friend of mine who was into it. So during that time, if you were around during that time 20 years ago, we would get updates updates from the stock market on an hourly basis over the radio.
Okay, that so I don't remember. Radio updates, wow.
So we would have to sneak out of the of class to get hourly updates on the radio. We'd go to his car, we'd take the 10 o'clock, the 11 o'clock, and the 12:15 updates.
Wow.
And of course, if you trade that way, you will tend to make mistakes. You will
win some, lose some.
Yeah, correct. Yeah. It would mostly be a hit or miss strategy. And that's been the way how with me for most part of those 20 years of trading history. So for the first 17 years, I won some, lost some as well.
Right.
Until about 3 years ago, my trading strategy changed about 3 years ago. But during the first 17 years, it was hit or miss strategy. It's not like it's similar to playing in the casino.
Right.
It's
win some, lose some.
Yeah. Either you win or lose without any deliberate plans or
I see
or exit plans.
Right. And, you know. 17 years later, it changed. So tell us about that moment. What happened?
Well, exactly? I figured that I couldn't peg my financial future on a hit or miss strategy.
Okay.
So I decided to read up about investments, about insurances. And along the way, I realized that there's a group of professionals that help others who are in the same boat as I was.
Right.
And I met Joe Ferreria and Nanit Ferreria in a casual gathering.
Wonderful.
So I researched.
Great people.
I read up about them. And eventually I got to talk to them and that started my financial journey.
So what started to change in your strategy?
Well, first thing that changed was whenever I get my paycheck, I set an automatic I have an automatic transfer to my investment account, and then a certain amount for my expenses.
That's always then, wise. So you can't touch it. No, it goes there right away. Yeah. Okay.
And I have a budget for annual expenses. I also have a budget for my daily and for my monthly expenses. Yeah, and that has helped me with my expenses. I I made sure that I was spending within my limits with proper budgeting. And actually, it gave me freedom rather than
constraining, yeah. Mm-hmm. Or constricting.
Yeah, it gave me more freedom because I knew if I had this much remaining after setting aside money for investments and money for the expenses, mm-hmm. and the money that remains, well, mm-hmm. I can practically do or spend that for those luxurious items,
right.
I need to buy.
So thus that fantastic formula of earnings less savings equals expenses,
yeah.
Which is basically what you're saying, no? That freedom to work with that. Wow, wonderful. Okay, so tell me, when you started doing that, did you immediately see changes?
Did it take time? Well, I immediately saw changes in terms of having the discipline in budgeting. Mm-hmm. And also, I had to let go of the other expenses that I would usually go for. Mm-hmm. In terms of investment, I also saw changes because I had a deliberate plan with regard to my investments. Not
right.
all are in risky high yield instruments.
Instead,
yeah, I have now buffer funds for emergency
right.
Situations.
Right.
I also have insurance coverage. Mm-hmm. Aside from the fact that also I have investments in mutual fund mm-hmm. and the stock market as well.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so more hit than miss this time.
Yes.
I mean, right. safer things, yeah. making sure you have the buffer, etc. Now, as this was all happening and it was stabilizing, when you look back, were there major mistakes you felt that you had experienced and now you're able to correct because of these strategies?
Yeah. Several years ago, I purchased an insurance policy which mm-hmm. I really did not understand fully well.
Uh-oh.
And
okay.
So when I had a session with my financial planner, mm-hmm. he explained to me the
implications.
Yeah. And insurances are not equal. And
right.
you can't just pull out a number, a figure.
Yeah.
Let's say this much millions.
I just want to be covered like this.
Yeah.
That's
not how it goes. Mm. Well, that's what I learned from my financial
right.
Advisor.
Because you just kind of pulled out a number and said, "Ah, gusto ko ganito."
Yeah, that's not how it should be done. We sat down, we made our computations mm-hmm. based on what I needed and mm-hmm. based on the projections, and we revised our my insurance policies, and then we also look into coverage for health.
Right.
Doctors are not fully covered when we get sick. We may not be billed by...
Doctors are not fully covered when you are
yeah.
sick. Okay, this is new information for me. Okay,
yeah.
How is that?
Well, we may not be billed by our doctor friends. Let's say if I get treated by a doctor friend, I will probably not be billed by that friend. But mm-hmm. we still have to pay for hospital bill, for the medications,
right.
and for the lost income. If I get sick for a couple of days, that
yeah.
probably will not matter much. But if, let's say, I get a debilitating condition, like if I suffer a stroke,
mm-hmm.
if I get a debilitating heart condition and won't be able to return to work
mm-hmm.
soon, then that will have a great implication on my financial status.
Right. Yeah. So clearly, you have to insure yourself, or get coverage.
Get coverage, have a buffer fund,
yeah.
and have enough savings or investments to see you through in
cases
case happens,
of like
yeah.
Situations. What other lessons?
Well, investing in mutual funds. Investing in mutual. Mm. I have been investing in mutual funds even before I met my financial planner. But,
okay.
well, my first investments were all in high risk
equities.
Yeah, correct. And high risk mutual funds as well. I realized later on that the risks are real. So when my investments
the
were making money.
Real.
Earlier on, mm-hmm. I tried to put more into it,
mm-hmm.
and then come 2008, with the bear market,
yeah.
I lost a little over 50% of that because they were all
wow.
in equities. So now I learned to manage the risks.
And did you pull out, or did you just keep it there?
I pulled out.
Oh, you pulled out.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm thinking to cut your losses already. No,
yeah.
okay, huge loss. Okay.
Yeah. So
wow.
now, even if let's say it happens,
mm-hmm.
I know what to do, and I'm sure I will not lose most of my investments
mm-hmm.
because of what I learned from financial planning.
Right, so don't put all your mutual funds in the risky portions,
yeah.
no, or risky asset classes.
Yeah.
Okay, anything else from those major?
That would be, yeah, those would
those
be,
would be the key ones,
yeah.
right. Okay, So now let's move to a point. So you're looking back, you see these learnings, you see what's happening as far as the plan is concerned, thanks to financial advisors. Did they help set up goals for you? And was that important in the changing of your strategies?
Yes, they did. What we did essentially was first to find out where I was financially, my current situation, and then they asked for my goals.
Was that hard for you to have to tell someone else, oh, here's where I am, here's my money?
It was difficult at start, yeah. But you
especially as a man, di ba? Parang hirap sabihin na, ito pera ko, this is my net worth.
Yeah, so, but I just put my trust in my financial advisor.
How do you do that? How does a person build I guess because you had done your background check, you realized these guys would really help you out.
Well, the first meeting was more of an orientation. Mm. That was very important
what because can happen, you get what to the services
and
are.
You get to know the advisor himself.
Better. Okay.
Yeah. So the trust was built up during those times.
Right. So he looked at your situation and then did he be the one to tell you what your goals are or did you determine that for yourself?
I determined it for myself and we set up a goal. I told him about my plans. Mm-hmm. Essentially, it would be retirement in 15 years. So he set up.
Sarap naman. 15 years, huh?
Well, I wanted to while I'm still healthy enough to enjoy the fruits of my labor.
There you go. And you would still practice.
Yes, correct. Okay. Retirement does not necessarily mean I'd stop practicing medicine. It just means that I won't depend on the practice for my income.
What a situation.
I can
huh?
do charity work, and that will not matter in terms of my finances at the end of the month.
Excellent. Yeah. You know, any final thoughts on advice you can give to general self-employed professionals and maybe even fellow doctors based on your learnings?
Well, my advice is for them to set up their financial, to start financial planning as early as possible because retirement planning is not done overnight. Mm. It takes years. Mm. And for me, I decided to have someone help me, have someone mentor me in fixing my financial plans because it's a very complicated matter.
Right.
And it's good to have someone mentor you rather than do all those stuff by yourself because if you do that, you'll be vulnerable in terms of making mistakes.
Sure, but if a person could, then as long as they set up the financial planning
Right? Yeah.
Excellent. Yeah. Thanks, Doc. You know, we'll have more questions for you in a bit. Right. We just have to take a short break right now, so stay with us. On the Money, we'll be right back. Welcome back to On The Money. Let's check what Salve Duplito has for us today in Salve Says.
How do you move people from knowing to doing? How do you help a shopaholic? How do you reform a big spender? How do you save someone right before he sinks into debt? How do you change behavior? Big organizations like the UN, the World Bank, Asian Development Bank, and governments across the world are taking notice. Financial literacy will help protect us from the bubbles and the crises that we've seen in the last decades. At the International City Financial Times Financial Education Summit held in Manila last week, people agree that having power over your money is a life skill that we need to have in the 21st century. This needs to happen on different levels. Saving and budgeting need to be taught in public schools and around your dinner table. It should be discussed by both the rich and the poor. Banks, insurance companies, fund managers have to help educate, especially the poor. This is too important to leave in the hands of economists. No disrespect meant to many of my economist friends. And you know what's great? If the poor can save, so can everybody. And it's already happening. In small pockets around the globe, slum dwellers are starting to use budgets and saving money. Technology through SMS messaging and web applications are helping people save. We all impulse buy, so why not use technology to help us impulse save? I have been so inspired by this conference that my next big thing is helping OFWs and their families here use remittance money for savings and investing, and not just for gadgets or investing in Ponzi scams. Join me. Share stories. Let's show On The Money viewers that this can be done.
Still with us is Tony Huerto, an anesthesiologist working in one of the country's biggest hospitals. He will answer some of the questions you sent us today via email, Twitter, and Facebook. Now, Melissa Hekulea, Mel, has those questions.
Hi, Edric.
Hi.
Hi, Tony.
Hello.
First question comes from Shirley, who asks, I saw the cost of your Good Health episode. I'm still deciding whether I can include monthly health card payments in my budget. Is it really advisable to get a health card, and how do I choose the best HMO? Mm.
It's advisable to get a health card. Mm. It's good to be protected in terms of medical conditions. With regards to the question of which HMO is the best, that's a difficult answer. Difficult question to answer because HMOs offer different coverages. But you just need to see what you need.
Okay.
They offer packages for certain types of conditions for certain ages as well. Mm-hmm. So you just need to see which one fits you, and of course the budget is also important.
Of course.
But it's good to have some form of coverage.
Okay. And what should you be looking for when you're choosing an HMO?
Well, you have to look at, let's say, if you're in your mid-40s, you'd have to look at coverage for heart conditions, for diabetes, for other problems which may be associated in that for people in that age group.
Right.
If you are young, then you can probably settle for the lesser the HMOs which have lesser coverage,
right?
Because you don't expect to be sickly when you're younger.
Okay.
But you'd have to revise that
older. Marvin emailed us and asks, do you have any tips for buying medicine so that we can save on money? I've seen all the ads on buying generics, but sometimes I still wonder whether the brand recommended by the doctor is better.
Well, generics are supposed to be as effective as the
branded.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just make sure that you buy from the reputable drugstores, and the ones that you get should be BFAD certified.
Okay.
How can you validate that?
Well,
you can
check from the drugstore itself.
Oh, really? You have a BFAD certificate in the drugstore.
You can ask the pharmacist whether this one is BFAD certified or not, or DOH certified or not. Because
the drugstore itself, or the particular drug.
The drug.
Okay.
Yeah, you can ask a pharmacist in the drugstore. Mm-hmm.
Now, why do doctors recommend certain brands? Is there a reason for that?
Or why can't they
just also write the generic on there?
Some doctors just want to make sure that you get a drug that is trusted. Doctors know that some patients would go to a generics drugstore and may buy those which are not certified by the BFAD or the DOH.
Okay, so basically generics are fine, just make sure they're BFAD registered.
Yeah, correct.
Okay, now Gabriella asks, is it true that only doctors can buy shares in a hospital? I am planning to buy some in a hospital being constructed near my house because I heard this is a better investment than an HMO. You get free rooms and great service when you're hospitalized and such. Would you recommend this, and how can I go about this?
There are some hospitals I know which accept non-doctors as investors, and in return they will offer you HMO-like benefits.
Mm-hmm.
However, the issue with that is your benefits will be limited to that particular hospital. So if you want to try out other hospitals, then you'd have to go for an HMO. Mm-hmm. So you'll have options with regards to the hospital and the doctor as well.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. Go ahead, Mel.
Okay. And I guess if you need specialist treatment and your hospital doesn't provide it, then you've really got to pay out anyway.
That's another issue.
Yeah. And are these hospitals that offer that the bigger ones or the smaller ones?
These are the smaller ones, as far as I know.
I see. Okay, it's advantageous for them, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Makes sense. Okay.
So maybe consider.
So watch out for those.
Yeah, and consider getting an HMO,
maybe.
Yeah.
You never know what might happen. Anyway, Dawson says, I'm a pediatrician. I get an average of 20 patients a day. While wow. I earn good money, I only have jewelry, shoes, and bags to show for it. I know lifestyle is part of the problem. What should I do?
Well, I think almost everyone falls into that trap. Mm-hmm. If you make some money, you tend to spend it on luxurious items.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I guess the best thing to do is to have discipline to budget your expenses. Mm-hmm. You have budget for investment, you have budget for expenses, and whatever remains, you can use for luxurious items.
Right.
If you can't do that on your own, then I suggest getting a mentor to do that for you, to help you do it.
Well, at least she recognizes that she probably overspent.
She has that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Instead of buying bags and jewelry, maybe hold back this month on that stuff, put that money aside, mm-hmm. and start putting it in an investment
fund. Right.
Yeah.
Now, is 20 patients a day a lot or
a few?
That's
20 patients is a lot.
So she's getting a lot of business, she but mm-hmm. she's just not putting it mm-hmm. in her pocket.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Be intentional, right? That's very good. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Set
oh
up a plan, know what you have to spend.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right.
So discipline, maybe don't buy that bag. Mm-hmm. Buy a mutual fund or something. Okay, Nadine says, how do we choose the best doctor? My horror story is that one doctor saw my benefits in the bank
Uh-oh.
I used to work for and gave me so many treatments, I ended up being in and out of the hospital for a month without getting well. I spent a lot too. Can you please give me the name of that doctor so I can go to them?
Well, first of all, how did they see that? The bag in the bag.
I know, exactly.
Right? Your thoughts?
No idea. Well, what's important is to get a doctor you trust. Mm. That's the most important thing. And if you don't know a doctor you can go to, then you can ask your friends, mm-hmm. ask family who have seen a doctor for that would treat the condition you're in. Mm-hmm. And basically, that's it. You just need to find someone you trust, someone who will not take advantage mm-hmm. of your...
Right.
Friends would be a good place to find trust uh-huh. for doctors.
Yeah, services mm-hmm. aren't really allowed to do that. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, ask friends, family mm-hmm. for a good doctor.
Yeah, people you know, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And when you think that your doctor is making you undergo mm-hmm. too many treatments, maybe just tell them to stop or say, I want mm-hmm. a second opinion.
Yeah. Choose another doctor.
Yeah,
is that possible?
Second
yes.
opinion
yes,
is always doable.
It's possible. Yeah.
Especially if you've been sick for a month and you're not getting well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's very telling, right?
Exactly.
Man, can a doctor be, you know, cited for that or penalized for that if it's actually proven?
If it's proven, they can file a complaint.
Like malpractice, right?
Mm-hmm.
They can file a complaint if they feel that some wrongdoing.
If someone, yeah.
yeah,
they took
you know,
advantage.
They're milking
they made
and
you
they're
go
not really
undergo all these
it's placebo,
tests.
Right? Like they're giving all these things that don't really help. Okay.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Good to know.
Anyway,
good
send us your money questions via email or through Facebook and Twitter, and we'll try to answer them in our upcoming episodes or on our next Q&A Friday.
Yeah. Have a plan. It's always good to know that, right?
Yeah.
So that you can know where you're going and not do a hit and miss,
correct.
As we've been learning. Yeah. Thank you, Doctor, for your story. Mel, great show again. That's our show today. I'm Edric Mendoza. Join us again tomorrow for more talk and tips so you're always right on the money.